this time, I'd like to welcome everybody, welcome all the news media, Eden or Reedsville Review or Madison Messenger, whichever one it is, it's the one that has all three papers in it, and Forrest Bray from RCENO, and especially Rockingham Update and Roy Sawyers, that's going to be streaming this live, and then it's taped and put out on Channel 2, Rockingham Community College website. So I do want to thank Roy for all he does for that. If you got a cell phone, if you put it on vibrate, I appreciate it a lot. And again, welcome to this beautiful fall evening or night. And at this time, we're going to have the invocation done by the county manager and the Pledge of Allegiance led by Commissioner Cardwell. So if you'll stand with me at this time, we'll do those two items.
If you would, please join me in prayer or bow in your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you in the mighty name of your name. Thank you and praising you for our great county. I thank you for the plan you gave to our forefathers by which to govern our nation and for the division of powers to that our destiny that does not rest in the hands of one person. Praying for those in authority, I therefore lift up the Board of Commissioners to you. I pray that by your holy power, our commissioners will remember they have our community in their hands when it comes to making it's a better place to live, work, and enjoy. Father, I ask you to give them wisdom to make decisions that would strengthen and prosper the entire populace of our county. I desire that they would make right decisions concerning the politics, the social welfare, and the economics of our county. I pray that they will be motivated by your hand and not their own personal concerns. In our Heavenly Father's name we pray. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. All right, at this time we'll, as far as the approval of the November 4th agenda, there's one item of new business, which is a part of the Phase 3 art project for the Justice Center that we need to add, and that would be under the new business item 11. And commissioners, you've had this agenda for a while. If there's any discussion or any changes other than what I just read, we'll hear them at this time. If not, I'll entertain a motion for approval of the November 4th, 2013 agenda.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Also, as we got started, one thing I forgot to do is call the meeting to order. This meeting is in order. Well, it's my anniversary. What can I say? I forgot something. But the Rockingham County Board of Commissioners regular meeting is in order for November 4th, 2013. All right, get down to the consent agenda items.
I made a motion.
Oh, excuse me. There you go. Got a motion made by Commissioner Craig Travis and seconded by Commissioner Richardson. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. Thank you. Now I can get caught up now since I got my anniversary thanking out of the way. The consent agenda. Gentlemen, you've had those, and the breakdown of the consent agenda is on the little stand as you come in if you want to see the entire breakdown of the consent agenda. What's on the regular agenda is abbreviated portion of that. And so at this time, if there's no questions or comments concerning the consent agenda, I'll entertain a motion for approval.
So moved.
I have a motion made by Commissioner Richardson. Do I have a second?
You do.
Have a second by Commissioner Travis. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried. This time we get down to the public comment period. And we had one person to sign up. And I hope I get it right. Is it Norman?
Yes.
Okay. Norman, come on up and give us your name and address. And you'll have 3 minutes to speak about whatever you wish. Thank you.
Chairman Nate and Commissioners.
If you would, move the mic over close to me. Thank you.
Okay, is that better?
That'll work.
Does that work? I come before you to request your help in obtaining high-speed internet for our portion of Baker Crossroad and other areas of Rockingham County. Scott Przewanski was a guest on The State of Things with Frank Stacio on WUNC Public Radio on Wednesday, October 23, 2013, stating that there is 98% coverage of families who want DSL in North Carolina. This statistic appears very misleading and quite untrue. On October 24th, my wife sent a letter to Mr. P., who is the Director of Public Relations for the East Coast for Time Warner, requesting his help in obtaining high-speed internet. As of this date, we have had no response. Time Warner has run cable from NC-65 down Baker Crossroad eastward to the last home on Rock House Creek. That's a distance of about 1.5 miles, and about 8 homes are connected in that stretch. And it's reported that they are running cable down Vernon Road from County Home Road south to the last home, a distance of about a half mile, a maximum of about 8 homes that would be tied in. A neighbor has canvassed people on Baker Crossroad on our portion from Sandy Cross to our home, which is the top of the hill before you get down to Rock House Creek, and found that 12 people are interested in getting cable. This is more than the other section of Baker Crossroad that already has Time Warner. It should be obvious that to run cable on our section makes economic sense. Cable has been run down Sandy Cross from the log cabin store to Baker Crossroad and possibly further. Children in our public schools, am I out of time?
No, you got a minute. Go ahead.
Okay. Children in our public schools have iPad devices that they can use at school, not at home, because they can't get DSL at home. I have contacted Senator Phil Berger and Representative Burt Jones to enlist their help in getting DSL for us. I have a copy of the letter to Mr. P and a list of the 12 people who are interested in DSL on our road. I would hope that y'all can light a fire under someone at Time Warner or AT&T to run cable down our section of road and other parts of Rockingham County. And I understand that CenturyLink in the western part of our county has tied in a lot of people, but Time Warner and AT&T seems to be dragging their feet. So I would appreciate y'all's help, and good luck in the fight. Looks like it's uphill.
Okay.
Anyway, here's a copy of a letter that my wife sent to Mr.
If you want to submit it to the county manager, you can.
Okay.
And Commissioner Travis has got a question for you, Norman.
Norman, what was your last name, Norman?
Norm Lenhart.
Lenhart?
L-E-H-N-H-A-R-D-T.
Okay. And could you give us your address for the record, because all this is being taped?
I'm sorry. We're at 1999 Baker Crossroad.
Okay.
We're right at the top of the hill, the log cabin, before you go down to Rock House Creek and Vernon Road.
Okay. What I wanted to say, Norman, is Mark Wells is out in the audience, and he's been heavily involved in the internet side of this, and he can probably help you with getting a petition set up in your neighborhood so he can present it to Time Warner Cable. He's been working on this for quite a while, so he probably can help you. Mark, can you raise your hand? Just get with him after the meeting, and he can probably help you a little bit, okay?
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Commissioner Duncan?
Well, I guess this could be directed to staff or to Mark, but I know, and I think I asked this question before several months ago regarding Time Warner, but for all of these companies, I know they're regulated by the state, right? Mm-hmm. Their franchise agreements. Have we ever looked at their franchise agreements and reviewed them, or do we, is that getting out of our league?
It will become a
state issue
matter as it expires, and I don't think there's anything particularly specific in regards to this type of issue with the broadband. but we certainly tried a number of avenues to encourage broadband growth. It is kind of an uphill battle.
Okay. All right, thank you, Norm. At this time, we'll get down to the commissioner's comments, and let's go ahead and start with Commissioner Duncan.
Well, I thought I might just give the board an update on our last CenterPoint meeting we had about a week and a half ago, and I try to get all as much information I can to the board members that revolve around our meetings and our discussions, but, you know, as some of you may know, that we may be going in a new direction, being forced to merge with other areas, such as Smoky Mountain region. I know at our last meeting that was the main topic of conversation, and, you know, we're with Forsyth Stokes in Eddy County, which we have probably one of the best setups in the state right now, but we did have a guy came in from Catawba and did a presentation on consolidation. So I guess maybe next meeting we're going to hear an update on that. I just wanted to bring it to everybody's attention, and it's quite an interesting meeting, and that is a very complex organization, and I thank y'all for putting me on it. And I did decrease the deer population by one on the way home that night in Rockingham County.
Okay. Thank you, Commissioner Duncan, for the update. Commissioner Travis?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to say I've been reading the papers the last couple weeks, some very disturbing, but I wanted to give people an update on 4-H. I know one article pretty much kind of threw Senator Berger under the bus saying he's not doing anything, but I'm here to tell you that Senator Berger and his office, Burt Jones and Brian Holloway have really been on top of this from day one. If someone would probably do some fact checks, they would have found this out. But Lance, can you give people an update on what Senator Berger and the representatives have done so far for the 4-H?
Just briefly, they have attended for this particular 4-H camp to close. Senator Berger and his staff did intercede, met with the chancellor from NC State University. After the conversations with them, they told their staff at Raleigh to allow the Betsy Jeff 4-H camp to continue as usual. State is working with them on developing a business plan to keep it going. We have a stakeholders meeting on Wednesday there. Chairman Mabe and I met with them last week. We're meeting again on Wednesday to come up with a plan of action to present to NC State to keep the camp running. The big issue is that they've had a decline in summer camp students or representatives, and we're going to work with them to bring it back in play. But yes, they all three have worked very diligently, particularly Senator Berger's office, in keeping up with us on a daily basis as far as where they were with the results.
Right, and I just want to say, I don't know if the citizens in the county know, but our representatives in Raleigh, they really work with the county and the county commissioners on any issue that we bring before them, and they really act on it. So I'm appreciative of representatives and Senator Berger and Brian Holloway and Burt Jones for what they do for us. With that, Mr. Chairman, I thank you.
Okay, thank you, Commissioner Travis. Commissioner Cardwell.
I don't have any comments.
Going to reserve your 3 minutes another time.
Yeah.
All right. Commissioner Richardson.
A couple things. The Rockingham County Public Library, which you can find at www.ropl.org, now has e-books available for you. So if you've got a library card, and you can either go directly to that site or you can go to the county website, which has a link to that. You can get e-books from the Rockingham County Library, and I'd like to make folks aware of that. Also, you have an opportunity this year to, if you want to give an in-kind sort of gift of $25 to whoever you like and give credit for a charitable gift and get the deduction for your income tax, Rockingham County's Partnership for Children, Smart Start, has these sheets available. where you can participate in that. This is done with the help of the Dolly Parton Library Campaign, and it's a way to get appropriate reading material once a month into the hands of a preschool student. So I would encourage you to do that. In fact, on the table outside are some of those sheets, and we're going to have them down at the reception area, Mr. Manager, or anybody that would like to participate. So I'd encourage you to do that, because that money and those books will be going to Rockingham County students and should give them a leg up as they prepare for kindergarten. In regards to the Wi-Fi or broadband, we agree with you. It's a tough nut to crack, Norman. It's, but I am advised by AT&T and Verizon, talked to representatives of both of them, the most effective way is citizen letter complaint. So I would encourage all of you that are so inclined to write a letter, phone up, but make contact with your carrier and let them know how dissatisfied you are with their service. And we intend to help you as much as we can, but it is an uphill road. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Good. Thank you, Commissioner Richardson. Only, and I'll be quite brief, I went down to the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Board of Directors meeting this past weekend, and it is a very powerful group. It's about 50 folks, and out of those 50 folks, we get together and decide what the county commissioners are going to work with the legislatures on, what things are important to counties, and what bills may be coming up that may be harmful to counties. And we get together two or three times a year, and we'll end up putting those ideas down of what bills we want to help the counties and what bills we want to stop. No different than some of the bills that we were successful in last year was keeping the unfunded mandates down, keeping the DOT from being a county-operated system instead of a state-operating system, trying to get some of the ADM money back from the lottery and so forth. Those are the things that the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Board of Directors fight for, and we also have a lobbying group, so they're very powerful. As far as the DSL goes, DSL is, we're trying to get it throughout the entire county. That is a shortfall that we have. And Mark Wells is working with all the suppliers and vendors trying to make that happen. The PN4H Center, when we first heard about it, it was unbeknownst to us. We didn't get any fair warning. It was a dead shot to the heart. Everybody got upset over it. I was one. All of the other four commissioners called their representatives. I emailed them. And Phil Berger, Senator Berger, and his staff, as well as Burt Jones and his staff, and Brian Holloway worked real hard to make this happen. And a lot of folks and Phil Berger's staff especially worked on this to make it happen. But there's still a lot of work to be done to make sure that we have a viable business plan that NC State will agree with. Because the camp in Stokes County, where Brian Holloway lives, is under attack as well. So Brian's having to try to get that one saved as well. But we're trying to keep Betsy Penn, which is in our county, we're trying to keep it up and keep it running. But right now, it's still okay. Other than that, that's the only thing that I have. And at this time, we'll go down to the public hearings for Tanya, the Director of Planning and Inspections. You going to use the big board?
I'll use Elmo. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right, tonight we are looking at a rezoning for actually county-owned property. This is case number 2013-023. This case will take and look, the property is currently zoned residential agriculture and is looking to be rezoned to heavy industrial conditional zoning for shooting outdoor range. There are 7 conditionals to go along with the conditional zoning district. I'll read these just briefly to you. First one is all development shall proceed in accordance with site plan, including applicant submitted materials, and any changes may require a site plan amendment. The applicant is responsible for obtaining and complying with all required permits and approvals. Third is the applicant shall use best management practices for any additional grading and erosion control as shown in either USDA Natural Resources Conservation Service Field Office Technical Guide or the North Carolina Erosion and Sediment Control Planning and Design Manual. Fourth is a landscape buffer either planted or existing must be maintained in a healthy manner along all property lines adjoining residential zone properties as listed in Chapter 2 in the UDO. Number 5 is applicant must follow the special requirements for a shooting range complex, which are listed in Chapter 2, Article 7, Section 75H in the UDO. Applicant also shall contact the North Carolina Department of Transportation to determine if a commercial driveway permit is needed. And the 7th one is a 50-foot undisturbed buffer is required around all intermittent and perennial streams as shown on the most recent version of the quadrangle topographic maps prepared by the U.S. Geological Survey, as indicated in the Rockham County UDO. Additional information that y'all would like to know is property we're looking at rezoning is approximately 33 acres. The property is currently has a private well and septic on it. It is currently zoned residential agriculture and residential protected. What I'd say staff notes for this is property does not lie within the watershed overlay district. And of the 8 applicable growth management strategies from the Rockingham County Land Use Plan, 8 support this request. What you would also like to know tonight is that the adjoining property owners within the 1,000 feet, which is the red circle you see on the map, were mailed notifications beginning of the month. Planning Board heard this on the beginning of October. Planning Board heard it October 14th. Newspaper advertisements were in October twice at the end of the month. We did have 2 phone calls on the rezoning after it was posted, and they were just inquiries, no pros or nays against the project or for it. At this point, I guess we'll just take questions, anything y'all have for me.
All right, let's see. Commissioner Caldwell, do you have any questions or concerns?
Yeah.
Commissioner Richardson?
No questions.
Commissioner Duncan?
No questions.
Commissioner Travis?
No questions.
The question that I have, anybody call against the rezoning?
No one against it, just asking questions about what the rezoning was about.
Okay. And at this time, there's several people who signed up to speak, and at this time, I'll call on those, so you may want to stand by, Tanya.
I'll sit by.
And Billy King. And Sam.
Chairman and Commissioners, I think they may want me to go over just a little bit of this. Bill Lester did the presentation for us at the Planning Board meeting. He had a death in the family, so he's not able to be here tonight. I'll just hit a couple of the highlights with this. The firing lines are 1,000 foot from any residence. That's an established NRA guideline. The property buffers on the 2 sides are a 200 foot minimum, which we have in the design. Where it abuts the landfill property on the end, there's no buffer restriction there. We can butt right up to that property because it's zoned the same as what we're trying to zone this. If you'll notice on that design, one of the things that we did was NRA standards call for 20-foot berm heights on the ends where the targets are, and we increased these to 30-foot high for just added protection.
Point at the map so they can see what you're talking about. You right here, look at the Elmo.
It's not on there.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry. It's not on there.
Oh, sure. Okay.
And, okay.
You might have to help.
Yeah, I think
you can. Tanya can help you. Tanya.
No. on the screen, right, Rocky?
Got to get Ronnie up to speed on this stuff, too.
Yeah, it's tilted, I can't see it. There we go. If you look right here and here and here, that's where we increased the berm heights from 20 foot to 30 foot. So we're actually above the NRA guidelines for that. And to give you an example, if you look at the front of the courthouse, that is about 30 feet high. So that's how tall those berms would be. So I think we went above and beyond the standards for that. The other thing that we had the deputies go out there and do a sound test for us. They had some sound equipment. And on the highway out there, with no traffic, the noise level was 49 to 52.5 decibels. With car traffic, it was 59 to 65 decibels. And with truck traffic, 63 to 75 decibels. And if you see for the weapons that they fired, and what we did is we had a deputy go down to where the firing lines were and a deputy up at the road to take the readings. The .45 caliber pistol was 65 to 67 decibels, 12-gauge shotgun 61 to 62 decibels, and a .223 rifle 67 to 71 decibels. So truck traffic is actually louder than their firing equipment. And that's about it. I'll be glad to answer any questions about it if you have any.
Okay, Commissioner Travis got a question for you.
Ronnie, the biggest complaint I got so far has, of course, been the noise. Can you, with your decibels, can you relate on what we're talking about here?
I can. Your garbage disposal, dishwasher, car wash, propeller plane flying over is about 80 decibels, so it's higher than anything we have. Passenger car at 65 miles per hour, 77 decibels. Living room music, radio is 76, a vacuum cleaner is 70 decibels.
So pretty much the equipment out at the landfill and operating is probably louder than what's going to be out there?
Yes, sir.
Another complaint pretty much I was getting was nighttime. Are y'all going to set up a time frame on when the fires take place?
Let me let the sheriff address that.
Mr. Travis, I just had made some notes here, but originally we had set this up to be within the compliance with the noise ordinance time period, which is basically 8 a.m. To 10 p.m. And if I need to be flexible, then we can adjust.
Right. Just to give a little about everybody a little history on it, if you don't mind, Sam, how we got to this point, what was the reason for us looking at a shooting range? Your deputy's going to Greensboro, travel at expense. Maybe you can give us a little rundown on that.
Well, originally we had our own firing range for years until the county high school was built, and then during a period of time the school was built and the parking lot was built, and when you looked at the berm, like you were talking about the 30-foot high berm, when you looked at the berm you could see over it and you could see the parking lot. We knew it was time to close it down. We didn't want to have any stray rounds going, so we closed the range down in 1998-99 when I came in office, and basically for the past 15 years we've been dependent upon Eden primarily through scheduling to be able to use their facility. And of course we also train tactical training our SWAT team members, and with our SWAT team members they do monthly training, multiple weapon systems, and again, like I said, is Guilford County does have a little variation, but then again it's the travel time, and of course, you know, we're on the clock, you know, when we're out training also, so it's a dollar issue also.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. No problem. Okay, Commissioner Duncan, you have a question for the sheriff or Mr. King? The all in all, by having, and Sam or Billy can answer this, either one, by having the firing range, it's certainly something that in time will reduce your expense. Of course, I know Madison uses Eden as well when they qualify, because my wife qualifies once or twice a year. Will they be able to use the county range too?
Exactly. When we first began the discussion several months ago into last year, the discussion was would other agencies be able to use, and yes, they do have their annual qualifications as we do, and we said yes to that. Yes, sir. So that was included. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, out of county agencies that would like to use that, is that going to be free, or will they be a charge, a minimum charge for them to use it?
generally what we've done, when we've done joint, like joint SWAT training, when we go over and train with the other officers, pretty much they allow us to use their range within scheduled periods, and then, you know, kind of reciprocating, kind of work together.
Okay, I didn't know exactly how that worked when you did it, but you very seldom have an agency just call you up and say, hey, we need to use your range for X time, and...
No, sir.
Okay.
I was asking Billy, the only one group that has not asked us, made an inquiry, was the basic law enforcement training program at the college. Of course, you know, from our office to the training site is probably less than 10 minutes drive. And again, I haven't had any inquiries from the college, and I was going to ask Billy had he had any, because they run a BLET program, and I know they can go certify, do the certification program in Eden, but they do two training sessions each year. And of those two training sessions, they probably have, what, two nights on the range, two nights on the range, something like that. So you're talking maybe four potential training periods if we were allowed to allow the BLET class to participate.
Okay.
And these are future law enforcement officers within our county.
All right, now this one may be for Ronnie as well. When we start this range, is it going to be done in phases? And how many phases will it be?
Well, when we talked about this originally, we brought this idea to the board, it's probably been about 8 or 9 months ago, and we had it phased out through 3 or 4 phases, and I think the board at that time said, let's cut it to 2. And so what we're looking at is trying to get the 100-yard range up and running for them to qualify, and the 300-yard range, and get the range house completed. And then after that, try to complete the close quarters battle or combat area after that is phase 2. And in talking with the sheriff and all, that's sort of their priority, is having those two ranges up and running. And then they can work on the other as to get time or money and do it like that. So we had broken it up into 2 phases.
Okay. Do you want to ask that question?
How did the planning and zoning board vote?
It was unanimous in favor. Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Go ahead, Sheriff.
Mr. Chairman, also did want to mention that there was a reference in there also, you know, we have some new business partners here in Montgomery County. We have Ruger. Of course, we've had Remington also, and it was a question about test and evaluation, if they needed to go out and test a firearm or something like that. But, I mean, that would be, I think that would be pretty infrequent.
Okay. Any other questions?
Just a quick one. This is confirmation. I think I heard this, that you're going to set the times, and you're going to be looking at noise and various other factors, and whoever besides the sheriff's department that is using the range will have to adhere to the times you set.
That's correct.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Thank you all a whole lot. If there's any other questions that come up, we'll let you. Billy, you didn't want to speak, did you?
No, I was just
asking
for a question.
Okay, all right, thank you, Billy. All right, at this time on the public hearing, of course, Sam and Billy signed up, as well as Ronnie. Miss Gunn signed up. If you would, just state your name and address for the record, please.
Sonja Gunn, 1324 NC 704.
And I'd like to point out where that is. Could you do it on the Elmo? She can show you how.
1 minute. They get 3 minutes.
Right.
Billy, is Sheriff okay? TV. We got to get that fixed, man. Maybe we're going to take a good angle or something.
Okay, you had our property listed. Our name was up here showing our property. And adjacent to the lane field, I would really like to see that with our names on it. I don't have any names on it.
Sheriff's got us.
We'll
get you here.
maybe the commissioner.
Okay.
You know who I am because I just told you. First, let me ask you to do this. Imagine that you live right there, all of you. All of you in here, imagine you live right there, directly adjacent to the landfill. We have a trail down by the creek. We have a trail that we walk for rest and relaxation and to get rid of the stresses of the day and whatever. So you just stay on that trail while you hear my plea. Our family home is on 28 acres that is bordered on two sides by the landfill. Our home was built in 1964, and you moved there in 73. The county needed a landfill, and it had to be located on somebody's back door. And we decided we were not better than anybody else to have it in our back door, so we didn't even protest the landfill, because the commissioners at that time told us it would be there about 20 years, then it would be filled in, and there'd be a beautiful park area out there that we could enjoy. That's 40 years ago. We're still waiting to enjoy that park area. In my immediate family, I have four children and a mother and a husband. We have five homes within a three-mile radius of this area. We have one on Smothers Road that has a shooting range behind it. Two of our homes are down there. The shooting range there, there's a valley up to 704. And up at our home, 1324, 704, we can hear the gunfire from that shooting range, or the skeet fire, or whatever it is. The two homes on 704 that are bordered by the adjacent to the landfill, have views of the landfill, and they readily hear much of what goes on at the landfill. The landfill equipment moving and covering trash, the commercial garbage trucks passing by and emptying their contents, and private residential, my son's going to give me his time.
Go ahead.
Okay. Private residential vehicles being emptied into the collecting bins. Now we are to hear the incessant gunfire if you do this, from 8 a.m. to 10 p.m., I just learned. Both of these homes are subjected to gunfire from the landfill, or will be, and our home on Smothers Road is also. So if the valley up there transfers the noise, we'll be hearing that on Smothers Road too. The fifth family home is located on 704, 2 miles east of the landfill. There's so much pollution from the noise, from the traffic on the highway, that you can't even sit on the porch up there and have a conversation. You cannot have a continuous conversation. That's all trucks, not just garbage trucks, but all trucks. I'm just trying to tell you how the noise already is. We do realize the benefit this landfill has provided to all of the residents of Rockingham County, but for those of us whose homes are so close to the landfill, this benefit comes with a high price. It's just a festering source of an ever-growing list of nuisances, beginning with the increase in traffic, smells that come from the garbage, buzzards, the noise pollution, and ending with the litter that constantly blows off the trucks and vehicles that are not properly covered. We think it looks like a World War II movie, and it will soon sound like one unless you stop it. The proposed shooting range will no doubt serve, which you just confirmed, all law enforcement agencies in the county and its municipalities, and others that you would be charging maybe from other counties, which will make it a very noisy and busy place. We were heard one time that the entrance was going to be on Baker's Crossroad, but now we understand it's going to be on 704, right beside our driveway. I just have one thing to add. You've got a landfill which will probably last you 50 more years. And why can't you just be satisfied with it being a landfill and stop trying to make it into something more? We do have to put up with enough annoyance from this landfill without you allowing more to be added to it. Isn't there any other area in the county where a shooting range can be located? Us and our families and our friends on 704 feel very used and abused by the things you try to do at this landfill. We think that when you were first thinking about the shooting range and looking at the map, you should have circled it like you did here and said, this is off limits. We will not put
put anything else on these residents. They put up with this for 40 years. Okay, I ask you now to return to the trail you're walking on, down by the creek, and imagine your reverie interrupted. Bam, 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 bam! Just like that, by the gunshots, and we know they're going to be that way, no matter how high you build your walls, it's going to be that way. Imagine the startle, the increase in the heart rate, and we know the human brain can get used to steady noises like we have gotten used to the landfill noises. But the human brain can never get used to the sporadic noise of random gunshots. Now, I know that I haven't explained this very well because I ate garlic for supper and my tongue is stuck to the roof of my mouth. But I hope now you will realize that you're very happy to go home to your quiet homes. We will not have this to look forward to ever again if you do this. I mean, we'll be dead before y'all get out from back there. So I just ask you to consider us when you consider putting this gun range behind our house, us and all the neighbors all around the landfill. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Guy. And I believe, is it Roman?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, I made a note on the sign-up sheet that you yielded your time to Sonia. So I just wanted to confirm that. All right, those are the only ones that signed up to speak.
You got all these, okay.
Yeah, all of them. And are there any other questions for Tanya or the sheriff concerning this matter?
I got a question for Ms. Gunn.
Ms. Gunn?
Yeah.
Oh, if you wish to address Ms. Gunn, Commissioner Duncan's got a question for you.
Why, just a quick. Did you say you lived on Smothers Road?
I just
wanted to address an issue about she brought up the trash. I don't think we have a handle on the trash coming off these trucks on the highway. I mean, it's on the highway 135, the truck's going to the landfill. It's pretty easy to pick out the route they're traveling because it's trash all over the road. You've seen it.
Yeah.
And I thought that when they went to the landfill, they would refuse those trucks if it didn't have the tarps on them. They're supposed to, right?
Yeah.
Lance, you want me to address that?
Yeah.
There is an ordinance about securing your trash coming into the landfill. It had not been enforced till Mike got here, Mike McElhara, new solid waste program manager. He has been doing that for about 3 or 4 months now. He's trying to remind people or have deferral as they come into the landfill to make sure that your loads are covered. I think he's trying to work with people so we don't turn people away, but he's also trying to educate them too. And if we see a repeat of that from that vehicle, we're not allowing them in the landfill. So we are trying to work on that. It is an ordinance. It had not been enforced till Mike got here and started enforcing it. So we are trying to work on that from private vehicles. The commercial haulers are, you know, their loads are secure. It's the private vehicles that come in. Citizens that we're trying to work on to educate them and make sure their loads are tarped.
I just know that Commissioner Richardson and myself have addressed this several times in the past. You know how much of a problem we have with trash in the county, and you know we're trying to promote a good image for our county and clean it up, and I just wish that everybody would get the message and try to do the best they can. And you know, we've got a beautiful county, one of the prettiest places in North Carolina. And, you know, trying to attract new industry in and just make it pleasant for all of us to drive up and down the highways. So I appreciate the effort he's making at the landfill. I just, you know, my advice would be if they don't have it properly contained, they probably need to turn around and go back or issue a fine if they can determine that it's not secure. And I'm sure that's what they're doing, but if we don't really stress it, it's not going to get any better if we don't enforce it. And I know the sheriff has told me that they try to look for it too, his deputies when they're out patrolling, and I appreciate that. And so that's all I got to say. I'm sorry you're having a problem with the trash out there. I hope it's getting, is it getting better, what you've seen? Thank you.
Okay. Lance, is it a way you can make sure they have your contact information so when they have problems like that, the county will send the landfill out there to clean that up for them so they don't have to do that?
I think Ms. Gunn has it, but I'll certainly make it more available if she needs it.
I mean, I don't think the residents should be picking up trash that's been caused by the landfill, so...
That's one thing you may want to look at in your next franchise agreement with the waste manager, whoever it may be, is to require them either on a monthly or quarterly basis to clean up their main routes, which that's not part of your franchise agreement now, but you can require that. So consider that.
Well, that certainly is a topic that we need to address, because I've seen it as well as Commissioner Duncan, where the garbage trucks that have stuff blow off the top. So. That's something we need to address at another time.
I've got something along that line, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, Commissioner Rich.
I don't know what Officer Tinker did with that, but I phoned in a complaint the other day following a vehicle that was spreading trash exactly like you described down the road. And I don't know if a ticket was issued or what, but I don't think the taxpayer ought to have to pick that up. If somebody spills it, they ought to pick it up. And Commissioner Travis and all the rest of us are interested in community service folks helping out with that and people that are identified specifically as being litterers, being part of the pickup team. I do have a couple questions for either Captain King or the sheriff, and you may want to come up. You gave the spread of hours, and we discussed that before on the phone, Sheriff Page.
Tell me once, he won't give it again. Okay, go ahead, sir.
Does that thing leap out? Because you're not the first.
It gets me every time.
Okay. You mentioned the spread of the hours,
right.
Of 8 to 10. How much are we really going to be shooting out there?
Well,
you can't afford to shoot those numbers.
No, I don't have that much money, but we don't have that much money. But we estimate that the max training periods would be about 32 training periods a year maximum, and would probably be less.
Does that equate to 32 hours or 32 days?
32 sessions.
32
and
sessions.
And the sessions, like I say, we do training when we do our initial training. It's over a couple day period, and it's usually about 4 hour sessions out at the range. By having the classroom, we also do classroom training too. So you do some classroom, and then you go out and you shoot. But also, we have to do the day and night fire, and I wasn't really clear on that. What we try to do is try to shoot our night fire training when it's like this time, when it gets dark quicker, so you do your daytime fire in the evening after you have your classroom, and then once you break and it gets dark, starts to get dark, then you can roll right into it, meet the standard. So again, you know, my goal is try to get out of there as quick as we can. But like I said, we could modify that too. But again, we do try to work with the daylight saving time for our benefit to get the night firing done.
It's not going to be every night.
No, no.
Maybe once or twice a month.
Well, again, like I said, we do two qualification cycles a year, primarily for our road officers and our civil officers. And again, like I said, it equates to about. It could say.
I think I got a good idea what you're talking about, but I want the public to have a good idea. Are we talking 4 hours a week, or are we talking two hours a day?
If we're going out to qualify the 100 sworn officers the first session, it could be between a 2 to 4 day period of time, and it could be anywhere from 6 to 8 hours of time, but a session. But the thing is, we're not firing the whole time because we have to do classroom also.
Weekdays only?
Yes, sir.
And what sort of notification? I think there's a safety flag you're going to raise when the range is hot.
You run the range flag up, a red flag up. That's when you indicate that you're operational. Plus, it would have gating also.
Would it be any way for the citizenry that lives adjacent to the range to know the hours that you're shooting on that particular day?
Use our call system?
Well, I mean, I'm saying right now is I know that if say, for example, we're going to go out and have a training session, I'm sure we could probably figure out some type of email, you know, internet system to call.
We got the call system.
We could actually do the call system there also, which is the Delta Alert.
Yeah, that's right.
Code Red or Delta Alert, which is the automatic calling system. If that's was required, we could do that.
To give the citizens more heads up.
Absolutely. Again, I live in Eden, and I live 3/4 mile from the training center also, and of course, and I know, and I hear the popping noises also. So I live a little bit further away than Ms. Gunn's house is on the property next door, but again, about 3/4 mile away, and I still have the popping noise.
I think we definitely want to be good stewards, right?
Well, she made a very good point. You know, when something is next door to your house, you know, it affects you. You know, affects your house or whoever lives there, and I would absolutely want to be a good steward because I know Ms. Gunn, and I want to be right by her.
Any other questions?
I got to ask one more question. I think I know the answer. Why don't we use silencers?
Well, that's a good idea. But not all of our weapons are suppressor, are set up for suppressors. The 223 weapons we use are non-suppressor mountable. And the ones we do have, now we do have some long gun bolt action rifles we use with our sniper teams that are actually suppressed. So you can stand right beside them and talk to each of us and you won't hear that much.
Yeah, I know some of the facility's not up there, but you and I discussed the military ranges that both of us have used in the past. And some of those, depending on where they were, I know you're going to do some tactical work, but some of those things, when you were in fixed positions, actually had baffles around them. So it was pretty hard to hear the noise.
Well, I think with Ronnie Tate is really my expert in design, the engineer. But I think with the berm system, that's going to route and control a lot of your noise. But again, like I said, you know, it depends on what type of weapons you're using. And again, like I said, you know, when we fire for a certain period of time, and there's breaks in periods, so it's not a continuous firing.
Do you feel like we're doing everything we can to avoid noise pollution and deal with the necessities of training our officers at the same time being considerate to our citizens?
I think that was the biggest consideration in Rockingham County when we're looking for a site suitability to establish range, because it's not a lot of places in Rockingham County where it is suitable for a firing range. And again, because the noise abatement is probably one of the biggest things you're concerned about. But with the decimal readings that we were concerned about is how will this impact others and how will that noise be? That's why we want to bring that information to you on the decimal readings. Because if you live near there and stuff, like I said, you know, I don't know all the noise, but I assume with the trucks and the different traffic coming up the road, I know those are some noise there. The mechanization or the equipment that's on the landfill, I'm sure that's heard. And again, I've been around gunfire all my life, so, you know, in law enforcement and military, so I've adapted to it, but also I know it can be loud. So again, it all depends on how you set your range up, but I think with the right standards, and I believe we're using some good standards, that it will help mitigate. I was asking Billy, is there any type of trees or anything additional you could plant that would deflect anything? And like I said, that's something we can look into. But again, I've never built a range before, so I have to rely on the engineers.
Well, I'm sure we're going to plant trees, but it's going to be a while before they're going to do much baffling, I'm sure. Thank you, Sheriff.
Well, I know there is some wood here, but again, like I said, that's what I was concerned about, is if there's any type of additional planting or anything that you do to mitigate some of the noise there.
All right, thanks, Sam.
Thanks, sir.
Billy, is there any other questions? Seeing that there's no other question or discussion concerning the...
Mr. Chair, before you move to calling for a motion, I did want to point one thing out. As usual, you have in your package a commissioner's analysis and statement,
right?
One for use in the event you move for approval and one if you were to move for denial. I noticed a clerical error in one of them, in the statement for approval. The title is correct. The first sentence, however, refers to approval of residential agricultural conditional district amendment, which is incorrect. It should read approval of heavy industrial, high impact use conditional zoning. So if you use that analysis statement, we want to make sure that the record reflects that those words are changed in that statement.
Okay, to reflect that it is...
That it's a high impact use conditional zoning, not residential agricultural conditional district.
Okay, I can add that statement before, as calling for a motion. Add what you just mentioned about high impact.
Yes, yes, if using the approval statement for analysis.
Okay.
Statement.
All right, at this time, I'll entertain a motion for approval of a case of 2013-023. And should we decide to approve it, the changing of the wording would be high impact use rezoning residential, agricultural, and residential protected to heavy industrial conditional zoning.
Yes, yes, that's fine.
Okay, I'll entertain that at this time. Oh, excuse me.
Since you're changing that, doesn't that need to be posted again so the citizens will know what you're changing it to?
No, the action is not changed. It is simply the language that you're using in choosing to take your action.
Okay.
To your statement of reasons.
All right. At this time, I'll entertain a motion for the approval as I read it just a second ago for 2013-023.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Got a motion made by Commissioner Travis. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Cardwell. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried, and it'd be carried with the amendment change on that page. All right, at this time we'll get down to Mark Wells. Thank you, Tanya.
You're welcome.
Mark Wells, Executive Director for Business Technology Center.
5 minutes.
Chairman Mabe and Board of Commissioners, I am here to swiftly ask for your approval of the revised strategic plan for the Business and Technology Center. You've had it in your packet. I presented to you a formal hard copy tonight as well. The intent here is simply to update what we have been working on with to show some objectives that we have going forward, also to highlight some successes we've had in the past. So I am simply going to pause for a moment and have you collect your thoughts, and if you have any questions, I'll answer those. But really, what I'm here tonight for is to seek your formal approval of the plan so that we know what direction we're heading for the next 3 years.
Okay. Okay. Let's see if there's any questions. Commissioner Travis?
Yeah, well, Mark, I ain't got a question for you. I just want to, Lance, you reviewed it. What's your thoughts?
Well, after reviewing it, I did sit on his advisory board. We did approve the strategic plan regardless of how the economic development landscape looks for Rockingham County next year, the year after. I think that his programs that he has in place, regardless, will stay and be conducive to economic development, the SCORE program, the STAR program, and other programs. So I think that his plan will adapt to whatever the landscape may look like in the county.
It'll be okay if the merger happens?
Yes, it can be modified. Right now you're approving his three-year strategic plan, but again, it's a year-to-year basis. Next year it'll be another 3 years. Next year, after year after that, it'll be another 3 years. So it can change however it needs to. But basically, all his programs would coincide with what we want to do with our future.
Thank you, Mark.
Just to add to that, anything that we do is at your pleasure. So you direct us, and this is just simply to give you an idea of where we stand today, and to ask for your guidance if you want any changes. But we'll certainly adapt to anything.
Commissioner Duncan, any questions? Commissioner Carpenter.
No question.
Commissioner Rich?
No, I stand ready to make a motion that we follow suit and approve the three-year strategic plan.
Well, I'll entertain that motion at this time, Commissioner Rich.
So done.
All right. Got a motion made by Commissioner Richardson, got a second by Commissioner Duncan. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carried.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Mark. All right. This time we get down to the county manager. Got a couple of items that we need to work with, and when we get down to the appointments, we're going to just correlate those all together.
Okay.
All right, go ahead.
The first one is in reference to the security upgrades. I know that was part of our projects that we were going to consider. I wanted to phase it in as phase one and phase two, or A and B. And as we looked at it, we felt, being staff, felt it would be more appropriate to go ahead and make those modifications all at one time. We have had some issues in the past with vandalism of our youth services facility. We've had instances over here where we have people roaming the hallways, coming up in offices, either selling products or just coming through the offices in general. And, you know, this day and time, things have changed, and society obviously has changed since years ago, and that's caused concern for staff and people roaming around in their offices. And so what we've got in your packet is a request to make a budget revision of $101,000 to make modifications to both the governmental facility here and the youth services facility. In essence, what it would do is it would install two sets of doors here and over here, and install card sweeps for both here, DSS, and youth services. And we also included the cameras, because if you'll go in Tinker's area where they review and look at the cameras, we had an incident here that happened, and I sat down with Tinker to try to review who the individual was that had some inappropriate conduct. We couldn't tell who it was, and the cameras were right in front of them. It's that fuzzy. And we have, not all the cameras are working. We want to make sure we change those out so that if there is activities that are going in the parking lot, such as we've had staff that has cars being damaged, people drive off, get the cars, drive off. We've had incidents in the parking lot where other inappropriate actions have happened. We want to make sure that if there's anything that goes on, we're able to see it, we're able to secure not only our employees, but our residents here who come to pay their taxes and do business here at the county. So we are requesting that you all consider the budget revision. Those funds would come from our non-departmental revenues. Basically, they're new one-time dollars for use on projects that would be a one-time hit.
Okay, I know that when you brought this to my attention, along with the other commissioners, I was shocked at the poor security that we have in some of these areas, and the security of our folks is, and the business that goes on here at the governmental center is very important. I mean, granted, we got a nice county and it's a nice bunch of people, but sometimes the nice people that are here get injured or disturbed by people outside the county. And I think we definitely need to have this budget revision done and these changes made as quickly as we can for the security of not only the people who work here, but the people who visit and the people who leave here, especially after a commissioner's meeting or whatnot, that may visit the place. Commissioner Travis, you got a question?
I got a question, Lance. I know you talked about youth services. I know, you know, for the last couple of years we've been talking about moving youth services, getting them out of that building. So why would we spend money for youth services if we plan on getting them to a secure building anyway?
Well, several reasons. The if the county commissioners decide to move youth services over to an existing facility, the PSAP building won't be constructed for another 18 months. So you've got some vulnerability for a year and a half. The equipment that we plan on installing over there can be movable, so it's not a fixed fixture. It can be moved to other places, and I'm sure that at that time we'll move it from where it is over there if, in fact, they move to the area they are now. So it's not something that we're just going to put in there permanently and just leave there. It's going to be something that can be
go with them. Well, you know, of course, I've talked to you about this before. I'm very heavy on moving youth services, so I can't wait to see that happen, because that building by itself is just costing the taxpayers a lot of money just to maintain that old building. So I'm all for that. The other question I have, you're going to be putting security cameras. How many security cameras are you going to be putting up, and where are they going to be?
Ronnie, maybe I can answer where they're going to be.
I know Department of Social Services had an incident with indecent exposure. Is that one of the areas?
They'll be all around. We'll be able to see all the areas.
On the outside?
Yes, sir, and there's some on the inside. We've got them, we've got some corridors where we're trying to, on the inside, where we put a camera and look down, like out here, for instance, where you could look down the corridor going to our office or down toward admin this way. And we've got the same thing down at tax. We want cameras down there that work and can look at where people make their tax payments at, look down the corridor going to DSS at the health department in Tanya's area. And also, we're going to put them up on the corners of the building on the outside. And I can't remember exactly how many. There's 11 total, I do know that. So, but that's what we're looking at. And we had a company come in and look at it for us, and we're sort of going by their recommendation of where they felt like with the cameras they had could cover the areas that we need to be covered.
Now, this is a, Lance, this is just a one-time expense. It ain't going to be no ongoing occurring expense every year.
It's one-time expense.
And we're okay with the finance on that, Pat?
Yes.
No further, Mr. Chair.
Commissioner, I'll skip.
Yeah, same question, different question. At youth services, are these just going to be recording cameras, or are they going to have on-site monitoring?
Now, at youth services, we're only putting in card swipes. We don't have cameras at youth services.
Okay.
Now, I was informed today, Johnny Bowles came by my office for to see Joanne about something else, but he said that he actually has cameras that he is not using that we could possibly use over there. He would make available to us.
That's fine.
So we
That's
may
fine.
Look at putting those over there. I got to check with IT, with Dave Wicker, and make sure they're compatible and will work as we need them to.
Yeah, we had some previous conversation about that. I was under the impression it was going to be temporary cameras over there, but not in the building. Like social services, it's a likely spot to have disgruntled customers, if you know what I mean. Well, they've made it quite a few years without it, so.
Yeah.
Okay, Commissioner Hardwell.
Commissioner Zuck. Just one quick question. I noticed in the front, as you come in the main door, we don't have, there's no ballast there, are there? There's a post embedded in the concrete to keep people from
driving through.
I'm surprised that we really don't have those, because most government buildings do that. They have the kind that you can remove if you need to get a service truck to the door.
Yeah.
I mean, somebody could take a vehicle and drive plumb through the lobby of that building if they wanted to.
You been thinking about that?
No, but I mean...
drive through and take your ATM out.
Take your receptions out.
That's something you can look into.
Put that out.
Okay.
Probably wouldn't be too expensive.
No.
Okay. Any other questions?
No.
If not, at this time, I'll entertain a motion for approval of the 101-320 budget revision for the security upgrades to the governmental center and the A&E Youth Services Building.
I move for approval.
I second.
I have a motion made by Commissioner Duncan, seconded by Commissioner Travis. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, likewise. So carried. This time, we've got one more item, I can't imagine.
Yes, we've got four appointment areas for a fire rescue commission, the Piedmont Triad Regional Council with Commissioner Caldwell, Zane Caldwell. Piedmont Triad and alternative Commissioner Duncan, and the same thing for the Piedmont Triad Transportation Advisory Committee, and then the Piedmont Triad Regional Council Rural Planning Organization. So you can either take those individually or all at one time.
Okay, if you want to take them all at one time, we will. Okay. At this time, I'll entertain a motion for approval of the appointments and nominations for those four items.
So
I have a motion made by Commissioner Richardson. Do I have a second? Have a second by Commissioner Travis. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, likewise. So carried. It's just time we get down to the new business item, can I imagine?
Okay, this is probably an item that you all know better than I, because it started before I got here. But when the courthouse started, there was a public arts project that the Arts Council and a committee was set up to do, oversee three phases. Phase one was to do the installation of the two brick murals on the right and left side of the courthouse. The design installation was completed by Mr. Brad Spencer from Reedsville. The funding came from donations and the sale of brick pavers with Mr. Bray purchasing the first paver. We appreciate that. And phase two was purchasing and installing artwork from local artists throughout the courthouse. They are doing that now. If you haven't been over there, it's very, very aesthetically appealing. There's some modifications that need to be made. Basically, it's artwork that was collected from local artists, professional photography, paintings, woodwork, pottery, and stained glass. Phase two is almost complete. There's a few more pieces of artwork they're going to get. The installation needs to be, there's were some issues with installation, but there's all coming to place now. But there, the final stage was phase three, and that is beginning the process, and I'm just giving you, this is an update only. You don't have to take any action on it, but phase three was to do something with Lady Justice, and you probably are familiar with that. But originally, they were going to have Brad do a brick Lady Justice in the quarter when you first walk in the entrance. But that wall wasn't built to hold that brick, so what they're going to do is they're going to put out an RFP to all the artists within the county to find out what would be best suitable for that. It could either be mosaic tiles, it could be quilt work, it could be a mural, it could be something else. But they're in that process now. It won't take any county dollars. They are going after private donations from the private rent. But the reason I'm telling you this is because it is a public building, and you all will have to be a part of the process as it transpires. When the RFPs are officially received, then we'll bring you all what the artwork will look like. Update you all on that because I met with them last week and they're proceeding in the process of phase three. It's kind of been in limbo until phase two was complete. Now phase two is almost at an end, so they're starting phase two.
Okay, and that's just an update. We don't have to do no action for that. Well, thank you for the update. And that takes care of the new business item that we added the first. Earlier, and at this time, one thing I do want to mention, because we're getting ready to wrap up, is that our next meeting is November the 18th here at the Governmental Center, and it's 6:30. But I do want to thank everybody for coming out tonight, and I want to thank the media and Roy for everything that they do. When we go into closed sessions, we're going to go back here in the conference room would be the best place to do this?
Yes.
Okay, and that way it'll give everybody a raw time to do what he needs to do out here. So seeing that we do have an item for closed business, pursuant to General Statutes 143-318.11 is to discuss personnel, I'll entertain a motion to go into closed session at this time. And we'll meet in the conference room right back here in the back.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
I have a motion made to go into closed session by Commissioner Travis, seconded by Commissioner Duncan. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed likewise. So carries. We're going to be.